Those spooky sounds you're hearing come from the first psychedelic symphony in history, the first musical description ever made of a trip, written way back in 1830. That's 130-odd years before the Beatles. Berlioz called it Symphonie Fantastique, and fantastic it is in every sense of the word, including psychedelic. That's not just my own idea. It's a fact, because Berlioz tells us so in his own program notes. He describes the young musician who takes this trip as being, quote, of a morbidly sensitive nature, and who poisons himself with opium in a fit of lovesick despair, unquote. The young man then has a series of strange visions during which, as Berlioz put it, feelings, sensations, and memories are translated by his sick brain into musical thoughts and images, unquote. Doesn't sound very different from modern days, does it? Now, we have every reason to suspect that the morbid young musician Berlioz is talking about is none other than Hector himself. He certainly did have fits of lovesick despair, we're told, and he was a creature of wild imagination, wild enough to have these visions and fantasies without taking a dose of anything. His opium was simply his genius, which could transform these grotesque fantasies into music. And what music? 5 movements of sustained invention that is simply incredible from a lad of 26, which Berlioz was when he wrote this, and only 3 years after the death of Beethoven. And what holds these 5 fantastic movements together? None other than the young lady who's caused this fit of lovesick despair. She haunts the symphony. Wherever the music goes, she turns up. An obsession, intruding, interrupting, returning in endless forms and shapes. Berlioz called her the idée fixe, the fixed idea that has taken possession of the musician's brain. So you can see that if we're going to understand anything about this weird symphony, the first thing we have to know is that idée fixe melody, the theme of the beloved, and be able to recognize it each time it appears, no matter how it's disguised. Here it is, or at least the first phrase of it. Can you hear the yearning in that melody, the rising shape at the beginning? Then rising even higher, straining still further. Then even further. Then descending hopelessly. Isn't that a perfect musical picture of lovesick longing? Now listen to it again, this time letting it continue into its second phrase, then its third, fourth, and so on, each time rising and straining further and further, and each time again falling back into despair. Now that you know the basic theme, let's hear it as it appears for the first time in this opening movement, which is subtitled Visions and Passions, and listen for the psychedelic fireworks. Thank you. Did you get what I meant by psychedelic fireworks? Those sudden flashes and changes of color, the dazzling unexpectedness of those dynamic changes from loud to soft and back again? There were dozens of them. And then when the theme came in, did you hear how those rising and surging phrases are each written with its own little burst of crescendo? And did you notice how Berlioz accompanies his melody, very strangely indeed, with no accompaniment at all under the melody, but between the phrases, there are those jerky little figures in the strings. Tick-em, tick-em, tick-em. And so uneven, always popping in where you don't expect them. Tick-em, 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 tick-em. And then the way the tempo is always changing, charging breathlessly ahead, then slowing up, then suddenly in time again, suddenly slowing up again. You never know what's coming. I tell you, you can become a nervous wreck playing this symphony. But then, that's what it is, a portrait of a nervous wreck. Well, by now you ought to have that theme down pat so that you can follow it in all its psychedelic disguises and developments through anxiety, jealousy, rage, despair, whatever. Here, for example, is a perfect picture of the agony of jealous rage later on in this first movement, with the strings moaning away on the idée fixe while the woodwinds heave heartbroken sighs above. Did you hear how that worked up into a climax of anguish? But if you think that was anguished, listen to how it goes on, with the sighs growing into howls and the strings rising to hysterical shrieks. That time he almost flipped his lid. This music sometimes comes dangerously close to the borderline of insanity. Every once in a while you think it may just go over the line, but it never does. Berlioz is always in control, no matter how insane he seems to get. And he does seem to get more insane with each new dream. In the second movement, for instance, our distraught lover dreams of a great ballroom with thousands of waltzers. He sees his beloved once more, to the tune of the idée fixe, of course, but loses her irretrievably in the mad crush that comes waltzing in on him. Then he dreams a country scene, all loneliness and dark skies. Whereupon, guess who appears, taunting him with her idée fixe melody, a wolf girl in sheep's clothing. Fourth movement, a new nightmare. He dreams he's a murderer. And whom has he murdered? Naturally, his beloved. And he must now pay for his crime at the guillotine. The agonized dreamer marches to his execution and bows his head to the blade. At that instant, he hears again the idée fixe, that melody hanging like an apparition in the air. But only for an instant, and bang, it's cut off, along with our hero's head. But there's a fifth and final dream which tops the whole trip, the nightmare of the witch's Sabbath. Now he's dreaming he's dead. In fact, he's attending his own funeral. But this is no solemn funeral. There are no holy words, no prayers. There are only the grisly shrieks of witches. Blood-curdling laughter of demons and devils. The diabolical dancing of Halloween hags and grinning monsters. And of course, who should be the chief witch? None other than that sweet little beloved of his, whose angelic melody is now transformed into a hellish, squealing ride on a broomstick. Then there are spine-chilling funeral bells. And a parody of the Dies Irae chant from the Mass for the Dead. Then there's the writhing of evil snakes. And the rattling of skeleton bones. And all this horror builds up into a most brilliant ending. But brilliant or not, I'm sorry to say, it still leaves our hero in the clutches of his nightmare. It's brilliance without glory. That's the problem. I can't honestly tell you that we've gone through the fires of hell with our hero and come out nobler and wiser. But that's the way with trips, and Berlioz tells it like it is. You take a trip, you wind up screaming at your own funeral.